Welcome back to The Breakfast here on PLOS TV Africa. Earlier, one of the stories that we spoke about in the news, the president, Muhammadu Buhari, of course, was quoted as asking that other nations do better with COVID-19 or support to developing countries. And of course, that includes with vaccines. And of course, that brings us to the conversation on how prepared Nigeria was and is and will be in case there is another pandemic or medical emergency or health emergency in the future. This morning, we're speaking with Dr. Bolaji Obadeyi, who's a member of the governing board, Lagos State Primary Healthcare Agency. Good morning, Dr. Obadeyi. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning. It's my pleasure to be here.
Great to have you on the program. I'll start with, you know, let's go back to, you know, how we have fared with regards to our response to COVID-19. Do you think, or would you say that, you know, Lagos State and of course Nigeria as a whole has done well enough, you know, with our response to COVID-19 so far?
Thank you for that question. I think one can say that relative to the resources that we have, the technology that we have, and the health manpower that we can boast of, I would say that Nigeria and Lagos State especially have done very well, commendably well, with regards to responding to the COVID-19 pandemic. If you recall, last year, 2020, it was completely unexpected, unprecedented. But somehow, as soon as the news broke in December of 2019 in China, from about January of 2020, Lagos State, through the Commissioner for Health, has been mobilizing resources, getting ready, thinking it through, and we're able to put up a good response to the pandemic. If you look at the structure of the pandemic in Nigeria, Lagos State is the epicenter for this pandemic, followed by Abuja, and then other hotspots in the country. So if we're able to contain the pandemic in Lagos State, which we have, then it means that we have done creditably well. We have also received commendation from other international bodies in our ability to prevent the COVID-19 pandemic from spreading across our country and the sub-region. So I would say with the little resources that we have as a developing country, with the manpower constraints that we have also, we've done very well. There's always room for improvement in any enterprise.
Dr. Obadeyi, I want you to clarify, because I think one thing that, you know, we still didn't get to talk about in the period, you know, that we've been dealing with COVID-19 is what exactly the reason is that the virus didn't spread as far and didn't become as deadly as other nations had projected for Africa and for Nigeria. Some people would say we probably were lucky. There was even people who said maybe it's the weather here. You know, the weather is too hot for it to survive, and some of all of that. But we've never really been able to answer the question as to what, you know, made COVID-19 not as deadly as was expected here in Nigeria.
Yeah, thank you so much. I think that's a million-dollar question. It's a question of many parts. I would say that it's a question that needs to be answered with evidence and science from research. We don't want to postulate and say maybe it's this and maybe it's that. COVID-19 is a disease that's barely 2 years old. It's going to be 2 years old this December. So all the research and the knowledge and the evidence base and the data that we have about COVID-19 is all 2 years, 24 months old. And that's a very short time to begin to make pronouncements about any disease at all. Polio, measles, and the others go back up to about 100 years. So this is something, a disease I think we need to build data and evidence about, and the research is ongoing. There is a research pillar within the Lagos State Response System that looks into the evidence and data that is evolving locally from the COVID-19 response, and I'm sure that all over the country, in other states as well as the federal level, there's a lot of research and thinking going on. I would say, though, that the public health measures we put in place across Nigeria were quick, they were decisive, and I think that's a small part of why the COVID-19 pandemic did not spread as much as it did. Nonetheless, there's still a lot of research, just as you say, to look into genetics, to look into the effect of the weather, to look into the effect of cross-immunity from other diseases that are endemic around us. What, for example, is the role of our immunity, long-standing immunity to malaria, in protecting us against COVID-19? These are all hypotheses. So research, I think, in the coming years will confirm definitively what are the reasons why the pandemic has not spread.
Okay, so let's go back in time now. Looking at the time where we had the Ebola outbreak, now we have COVID-19. Do you think that, you know, we have done better? Because some people are of the opinion that we practically managed the Ebola outbreak than the COVID-19. What are your thoughts?
I think those are two different templates. The Ebola virus and the pathophysiology of that disease is different from that of COVID-19. But where we have similarities, I will tell you, I think the similarities that we have with Ebola and COVID-19 is that in both instances, we had extremely strong leadership and governance. In the case of Ebola, when that happened, the government, you know, the first case was in Lagos State. The government immediately kicked into action. The governor for the state came back from a trip. The commissioner on the ground was all over the place doing what needed to be done. And again, with COVID-19, I think leadership has been strong in this particular health crisis, with the commissioner and with the governor taking charge immediately and working day and night to ensure that things went well. So while those two diseases are not exactly comparable, the case fatality for Ebola is much higher than the one for COVID-19. The means of transmission is different. The approach to prevention and control is also slightly different. So while there are different diseases, you know, with any emergency at all, or any outbreak, or any biosecurity threat, leadership is extremely critical. Governance is extremely critical. And in both instances, I think we've been very lucky with leadership and governance.
But another, you know, issue that is very strong is the issue of acceptance, and that has to do with awareness. Because if you remember the time of, you know, the outbreak of Ebola, you found out that the awareness was very strong compared to that of COVID-19. And then we had different conspiracy theory of how to solve the Ebola issues.
Yes.
Now, let's go back to what you mentioned. You talked about the Nigerian government acting in December. I'm thinking that we started taking action in March. That's when we started seeing deliberate steps and action. So yes, it broke in December, you know, in China, there about January. We were a little bit not too, you know, strong with our policies and action, February up until March. And that's when we started having the shutdown and lockdown across board. So what is, do you think that in terms of awareness, we're creating enough awareness, you know, with the pandemic's, you know, situation, and in the nearest future, what are we going to do to create awareness?
Excellent. You know, the key word there is visibility. There was a lot of action, good technical action going on in the background that the public might not be privy to in terms of what protocols can we develop, what handbooks do we have, where do we mobilize resources from, what are the what-if scenarios, what if this happens, how do we respond to that? What if that happens, how do we respond to that? Constituting the several pillars of the COVID-19 response, those are things that were going on in the background that the public was not involved in for at least 2 months before, at least a clear month before the first case we had in Lagos State with COVID-19. In looking at communication for the two diseases, comparing Ebola and COVID-19, you know, with Ebola, it's a more dramatic disease that you don't need to tell anybody, you don't want to get this, because there's bleeding from the orifices, there's fever, it's toxic, the person dies rapidly. With COVID-19, we even had so many asymptomatic cases, if you recall. And that means that for the average Nigerian or the market woman, when you say asymptomatic, the understanding is it's not there. The person's understanding of asymptomatic is zero infection, whereas in public health, we know that asymptomatic means you carry the virus, you're able to infect other people, even though you are not showing any symptoms. So that's where risk communication, we need to improve our skills as medical professionals, as sociologists, as psychologists, how we communicate the risk of these various different diseases to people, so they have understanding that while it's not like Ebola, where there's bleeding and there's death and you're very ill, COVID-19, if you are not serious, if you get infected, it can kill you as well. So that's an important part. In terms of preparedness, we often talk about the three M's. We talk about money, we talk about materials, and we talk about manpower. Those three are applicable for Nigeria in how we prepare for future biosecurity threats. These are biological emergencies. Diseases that occur as a result of changes in our ecosystem, in the climate change, the rising temperature, the fact that there's urbanization, which means we're now in close proximity to animals that we never used to relate with. So I think there will be future pandemics. There will definitely be more epidemics. In Nigeria, we're dealing with about five different epidemics as we speak. It's not just COVID-19, there's Lassa fever, there's a yellow fever, there are outbreaks of cholera, there's cowpox, quite a basket of things that we're having to respond to. And so I think we need to have a strategy as a country in terms of how we want to, this is the new normal. And it's not a very comfortable normal. How do we move forward as Nigeria? So money, manpower, materials, that's conventional. The non-conventional tool to add will be technology, digital technology, vaccine technology, and of course, lastly, leadership and governance. We often forget that. I say governance because when you look at how we were able to mobilize against COVID-19, you can have the ministry at the secretariat, you can have the federal government in Abuja, we still need other traditional lower governance structures to reach our people. The market women governance, the local government health authorities, the local government chairman, we leverage all of those platforms in communicating to people about what to do against COVID-19. So I think in preparing for future pandemics, the three conventional ones, money, we can't avoid that. Materials, we need to invest in our health system. Manpower, we need to develop new streams of healthcare workers, more public health practitioners, more molecular biologists, more epidemiologists, more people in the area of testing, which we had to rapidly expand capacity in, and so on. We also need to invest in technology. This technology, e-health, invest in vaccine technology, possibly producing our own vaccines ourselves here in Nigeria. And of course, we need to strengthen leadership and governance. That, I think, is the way to go forward with this unseen enemy.
Oh, Dr. Bade, it's, well, I'm not sure when we will get to that stage where we start to, prepare our own vaccines here in Nigeria. It might take a while. Seeing our investments in healthcare from the national level and in the state level also. But I want you to break down the discussion on preparedness, in layman terms, if possible, to understand better what needs to be done. Because the thing with pandemics and health crisis is you can never really tell if it's going to be one that attacks blood cells or one that attacks, the respiratory system or one that attacks the gastrointestinal tract. You can never really tell. And so there have to be systems that are put in place that would be, the quick response, that the state would put into action in case there is a pandemic like that. So what have you seen that we still lack here in Lagos and across Nigeria that you believe must be immediately properly invested in to prepare ourselves for another pandemic, if need be?
Okay, that's a very broad question, but I will approach it from the angle of what I do. I'm a health economist, so I will focus, for example, on financing, health financing. By the way, we used to produce vaccines in Nigeria in the past, and I think we can do it again if we just get dedicated government support. The UK government, as soon as the COVID-19 pandemic broke, provided, I think, £10 billion dedicated to just developing the vaccine. So that's the kind of approach we need to have. Be focused and put our money where our mouth is. Okay, on the issue of financing, just that alone, there's government financing of health, which needs to improve. That is the amount of money that government invests in health. Not just that, government also needs to look at performance-based financing. What are we getting for the money that we're putting in health? That is, are we putting money in the right places? Even more important and dear to my heart is the issue of health insurance. That is now household financing or personal financing. Okay, if we say government has done its best, government cannot do more. There's no more money. Government can't spend more. Can individuals spend more? Can we spend that money in a strategic way? Can we, rather than paying out of pocket, which means in a pandemic, you have your money under your pillow and you are waiting for when you're ill, and then you just put together what you have and go to the hospital, which is unlikely to be enough, because nobody keeps money for sickness. So in terms of the layman, that is, what can I do? I would say, individual Nigerians should begin to look more at prepaid schemes, at having a basic health insurance package, that is, subscribing to whatever you can afford in the various options which are available to us now, whether government health insurance or private health insurance, subscribing to one to such an extent that if there's an outbreak of a pandemic or an epidemic, and it affects your family, you can access healthcare. You simply go there with your electronic card. You don't need to look for money at that time. So that's one way an individual or a family can prepare for a pandemic, having some kind of cover that gives them access to healthcare services, not on the basis of ability to pay, but on the basis of their need. So when I'm ill, I pick up my card, I go to the hospital. And there are various prepaid schemes which are available now that are quite affordable. So in terms of financing, that's one thing we can do. Breaking it down again in terms of human resources and manpower, we need to take care of what we have. Frankly, I don't know how we can do that to prevent our doctors and nurses from going abroad. But not everybody is leaving because of money. Some people are leaving because they are not fulfilled, because they can't practice what they've learned. So if we invest more in the health system, our doctors and nurses, perhaps those who just want to, who have an altruistic motive, will stay and do their bit. We also need to train more. We're a country of 220 million people. One of our former professors, Professor Adetokunbo Lucas, God bless his soul, used to say that our problem is not brain drain, is that we are not training enough nurses and doctors. He thinks that, as a matter of fact, we are able to export even if we trained enough, like the Philippines, like Cuba, and other India and other countries are doing. So we need to train more and more health manpower of the right cadre. Not everybody needs to be a doctor. You can be a community health worker if that's the level of education that you have. You can be a nurse. You can be a pharmacist. There's so much of the various cadres that we need. So I think those are simple areas where the regular man can, the average Nigerian can begin to think about, how do I prepare my family for another different outbreak of disease, which I think will happen. Everybody should have some form of cover, some form of insurance cover.
Yeah. It's a lot of work, obviously. It will take a while before we get there.
All right, yes. but let's also look at the basic structures. You know, I know that you've mentioned that money is very important, and of course money would answer to some of, you know, the things that we will need, including the structures themselves. But let's assume that we have the money. What should we be channeling the money to? I mean, we're talking about structures. Now, for instance, when we had the COVID-19 outbreak, we started battling and grappling with the issue of isolation centers. In a lot of states, really, there was no provision for isolation centers. And then state governors started, you know, seeing how to pump monies and, you know, create isolation centers. So my question now is, what basic infrastructures do we need as a country across the 36 states, including the FCT, you know, in case there's a pandemic, there's an emergency, what basic infrastructures do we need across the entire country?
Thank you so much. That's a question we need to ask ourselves from time to time. There are three tiers of the health system. The base, the foundation of the health system is the primary health care system. That's the entry level. That's the touch point for more than 70% of Nigerians. That's the one that is closest to most Nigerians. It's the place where you can get the fastest health care possible. Above the primary healthcare level is the secondary level. Whatever can be handled at the primary healthcare level goes to secondary level. What can be handled at secondary level goes to tertiary level. I think if that's the way that the pyramid is built, the investment into the health sector should go to the base. You don't build a house and put all the money on the roof. We build the house and ensure that the foundation is strong enough. And that's the same approach we should have to strengthen our healthcare system. Investing in the place where 70% of Nigerians access their healthcare from. Making sure that the primary healthcare system works. Making sure that the primary healthcare system has the approach that is preventive, the public health approach. Clinical medicine attends to one person at a time. If you go to see your specialist, your gynecologist or your neurosurgeon, there can be 10 of you in the room, it's one person at a time. Public health is population health. It's the branch of medicine that looks at the health of groups of people in terms of preventing diseases and controlling the outbreak of disease. That's another area that we need to invest our money in, ensuring that we have a strong public health system, that our epidemiological skills and knowledge is strengthened, so that when we have these outbreaks, which we have all the time, cholera here and there, yellow fever outbreak here and there, we have the right manpower to respond to those outbreaks. What we see, unfortunately, is that we invest in the roof, we invest in the tertiary system. We should, don't get me wrong, we should have linear accelerators, we should have MRI machines, we should have CT scans, but if you decorate the roof and the foundation is crumbling, what we've seen is what we're going to continue to see. So I think we need to look at the allocative efficiency of our health system. Where should we put more money? It's the base, it's the foundation. Ensuring that there is a health post, health center that is functional, well-staffed, well-equipped, has drugs, that is close to everybody. So that if an epidemic breaks, we're not then, as you say, asking ourselves, where do we put these people? They simply go to their nearest functioning health center, yeah, where we have a designated isolation bed, at least one or two in each of those places, where we can put people who have this kind of condition. But if we don't have that, then what we're going to see is the last minute effort to quickly set up isolation centers. Having said that, let's give credit to all the state governments, every single one of them. COVID-19 has brought out some of the best in us. I think that every state can now boast of at least one, if not two or three, designated isolation centers. Those things were not there 2 years ago. So I think we're moving in the right direction. We simply need to institutionalize the COVID-19 response to ensure that the capacity is spread broadly across the health system, using, right, of course, the primary healthcare system as the base.
Dr. Bolaji Obadeyi, a member of the governing board, Lagos State Primary Healthcare Agency. Very, very interesting conversation. And I will say thank you your time this morning. Thank you for chatting with us. We wish you a beautiful weekend ahead.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me. It's Absolutely. A pleasure.
And that's where we'll be saying goodbye this Friday morning. Thank you very much for being with us all the way since 7 o'clock in the morning. If you missed out on any parts of our conversation, remember where to catch up. It's simply at Plus TV Africa.
Of course, on Facebook and Instagram and of YouTube as well, Plus TV Africa. And we wish you a very great weekend. I am Messi Boko.
And I am Osaugie Ogbonwa.